Good afternoon, everyone. Hope you're having a good con. My name is Preston Holder. I'm a Los Angeles screenwriter and occasional poker player.
Dangerous things.
I'm joined by...
I'm Jennifer Larson. I'm here, based here in Austin. I am a model, actor, cosplayer, video gamer, a little bit of all the things there.
I'm Juliet Kita. I am based in Austin, Texas as well, and from here originally. I'm a model, actress, singer, and I have a bunch of random talents. There are too many to discuss right now, but it's cool.
We could be here for days.
We're just awesome people here.
Yeah.
Ready to entertain.
I've met a lot of people at the convention, and one of the questions that's come up is, how did I discover this story? About which is historical fiction about the Soviet airmen of the Second World War. Some people think it's because I'm Russian. I'm not. I just happen to be playing a hand of poker one day, and I'm a fairly tight poker player, meaning I don't play a lot of hands, which is what you got to do if you're playing to make a living, which at that time I was. And you just sit there and fold, and random thoughts come into your head as you're staring at the same faces. And I remembered this joke that my father told me when I was growing up, but I could only remember the punchline. And the punchline, if you're curious, was, well, yeah, but these Valkyries was flying Messerschmitts. And so I went to try and find out what that joke was, so I typed it into Google, and I found this woman's face of this combat pilot, and she shot down a Messerschmitt as her first kill, and I was amazed. I had never heard of this story before. In fact, I did not even know that there were combat pilots until, you know, quite recently. You see in the news where they were starting to use them to bomb ISIS and so on. And I thought that was a great story, and I decided I wanted to tell it. So I'll give you a brief bit of history, and then we'll go on to kind of some of the choices I made to dramatize it. So, this woman is Marina Raskova. She was kind of the eastern competitor to Amelia Earhart. She set the long-distance navigation record, and then once the war started, she convinced Stalin to create three air divisions of female combat pilots, two bomber divisions and one fighter division. The women we're going to be talking about, Litvyak and Katya Budanova, were in the fighter division. You'll notice there, that's a stamp. They liked her so much in the Soviet Union, they put her face on a stamp. And those are the years of her birth and death, and as you can see, she died during the Second World War in service to one of her own divisions. The photography we have of these women, as well as most of the records, unfortunately, is not as well as we would like, but the woman on the left is Lilya Litvyak, who is of Polish descent, if you're wondering what kind of name that is, who will be played today by Juliet.
Me.
And the woman in the middle is Katya Budanova, who will be played today by Jennifer. And they fought for the 587th Fighter Squadron. That's a Yak 1 that they were flying. And they served with such distinction in their first combat that they were actually later transferred to what was formerly an all-male division, which I thought that would be a great opportunity to dramatize. So, I wrote a screenplay about it, sitting with Lionsgate right now, and Jennifer and Juliet reviewed the history and loved the screenplay, and they, independently of each other, chose their characters. So, you want to tell us a little bit about that?
So, I read through the script originally and was very intrigued by the idea of Katya, because we're in a very unique place in history right now where a lot of social dynamics are being challenged and are being changed, especially in the female community. For the very first time, we're seeing actual laws being implemented or turned over that are allowing more personal freedoms as far as who you can marry, who you can be with, the type of social norms that are accepted. So to be able to play a character that was chosen for this screenplay to be represented as homosexual was very intriguing for me, because there are so many issues that are being addressed in our media and in our culture. To find a way to dramatize that and to take a woman from history and portray her as kind of going through that struggle that we in this nation are going through personally, and to say that she, in the 40s, was going through those very same things under much more scrutiny and hardship than we have here in the country, It was, I mean, punishable by incarceration, to say the least. To have her struggling with that and eventually come to terms with it and be able to stand up for herself and kind of say, you know what, this is who I am, this is what I'm going to do, I'm going to fight for what I believe in, regardless of the way you feel about it. I think that that's a discussion that very much needs to happen in our country today, as well as the discussion of women in the military, women in positions of authority and power, and women struggling to be a dominant factor in a relationship. So the ability to kind of portray that and to make that discussion happen was very important to me personally.
Alrighty, I back up what Jennifer said. She pretty much summed it up. And Lilya, who I'm playing, really inspires me because she's very strong-willed. She will not take no as an answer when they told her that she would not be able to fight anymore. She proved to the girls that she could, and then she became one of the best female fighter pilots, and one of the first as well. And I really respect her for doing that, standing up for herself. And I think a lot of people need to do that nowadays as well. And it's important, you know, to stand up for yourself and for equality, to just not give up on your dreams and be who you want to be and be who you are. And, you know, don't lose sight of that. So that's why she really inspired me. She's also kind of stubborn, just like me, so it's kind of funny. But let's see. Are we going to talk about their lives right now?
No, not right now.
Okay, not right now? Okay.
Well, I mean, I'll tell you a bit about them. And looking at how I wanted to dramatize the story, I looked at what other people had done. And Lilya, the blonde one, she wasn't actually blonde, but she had a tendency to peroxide her hair, which is why we portrayed her with platinum blonde hair but dark eyebrows. And she was the highest, she remains today the highest scoring female combat pilot of all time. And most dramatizations of the Soviet era focus almost exclusively on her when it comes to the fighter story. She met a man named Alexei Soloveitin, and they were rumored to be engaged to be married, and he unfortunately died in combat. And after that, she started volunteering for increasingly dangerous combat missions. And it's a very compelling story. Everything I just said is the historical record. And so a lot of people will focus almost exclusively on Lilya, or sometimes on Lilya and Alexei. But I wanted to make it a broader story than that because, you know, we're trying to represent not only her individual accomplishments, but also there were, you know, three divisions of women who were helping win the war. So I wanted to bring Katya into that story, but I didn't want her to just be this sidekick-like character, so I thought a great device for dramatic tension would be to make Katya a lesbian and then put them in a love triangle between Lilya, Alexei, and Katya. So those were some of the dramatic choices I make, and people ended up liking the screenplay. It's a war drama, and there was a lot of meat there for me to really get into as a screenwriter. But then when I started looking to adapt it to comic books, the question became, do they have good comic heroes? And I feel the answer is yes. One, the story is very visual, and the comic artist who read my screenplay said there's a lot of great stuff here to render into comic art. But the other question would be, well, what is a comic hero? And to me, a comic hero is someone who acts on their convictions in order to try and shape the world towards what they feel is right and wrong. And in that regard, I feel that they are comic heroes. I think that they're non-traditional. I think our traditional comic hero is someone who is imbued with superpowers and typically the gift of anonymity. And I think that comes from, well, our childhood, where a lot of us started to read comics, and as children, that's where we learned right and wrong. And often we would attempt to act on our convictions, and in so doing, we would often discover our own powerlessness. So, and Lilya, well, I also forgot that. And that's why comic heroes are a great thing for us to fantasize about, because we get to think, oh, well, wouldn't it be nice if I was that powerful and could act anonymously to act on my own conviction? But I feel their stories are even more compelling because they were not acting on their convictions as the most powerful members of society or with superpowers, but really as the least powerful members of society. And I think that's even more compelling to us, because that gives us a call to action, that you don't have to be bitten by a radioactive spider in order to start acting on what you feel is right and wrong. So that's one of the things I really loved about the story. And I hope it inspires you. Something else that I kind of wanted to tackle was the notion of, because I am a father, the notion of childhood and how much our childhood shapes who we are. And I certainly hope that children have the best possible upbringing that they can in order to shape them for a better future. But these two did not. And we have a tendency in our culture, if you don't have a good childhood, to give you the victim label. And a lot of times that kind of disempowers you. And so through the screenplay, I showed that they had a very traumatic childhood and that they became flawed heroes, and that that is something that we can do. And so to kind of talk about the horrors that they had to grow up with, thought we would start with Katya talking about what happened in Ukraine.
So, a little bit about Katya's history. Her Ukrainian countrymen died under Stalin's forced starvation of the Ukraine, and an event that the Western world really recognizes as an act of genocide, but Russia does not. What we can tell you is that despite being the breadbasket of Russia, food was forcibly removed from the area. There were even house-to-house searches to ensure that no one could hoard any. The starving was just atrocious in that country. Outside countries offered assistance, but Stalin, who was in leadership at the time, wouldn't allow it. The Ukraine was going through a period of nationalism, and there was a question as to why they were taking their orders from Russia, even. It all stopped after millions of their countrymen were starved to death. The streets of the Ukraine were littered with the bodies of the dead. And Katya, at the time, was working in Moscow, so had plenty of food, and the newspapers wouldn't give coverage of what was going on. But her character was really addressed with the struggle of, do you acknowledge what's happening and attempt to get to the bottom of it to rout it, or do you kind of turn a blind eye and focus more on your own inner struggle rather than that of your people? So that's something that she's constantly battling with, as far as, is she content with being withdrawn and not speaking up for what she's really believing, what she's wanting, versus the struggle of making that hard decision to face the truth head on and do something to actively change it. And throughout the course of the screenplay, Katya is constantly facing this hem and haw between taking that and just taking a back seat to it and allowing Lilya to be the one who kind of carries the conversation socially. It's very interesting.
So, a little bit about Lilya. This may explain why she wants to go into war so much and fight for everyone. Well, her father was a Bolshevik revolutionary from Poland, and he risked his life for fighting for the communists to come to power. But when the fighting was over, he began writing letters and newspaper columns about Marxist theory and how a proper communist government should function. At the time, it was seen as patriotic, but then Stalin came to power and viewed things differently. And then he wanted to eliminate political rivals, so in 1936, he did it by telling people that there was a secret Polish plot to overthrow the government. Well, Stalin used that as an excuse to start having a ton of people killed. And the plot was a lie, but her father was doubly in jeopardy as both a Bolshevik intellectual and as a Pole. They wasted no time in coming for him. And she had attended his show trial where her father confessed to being a spy for Poland. And he did it so that Stalin would spare Lilia's life. Because, you know, if he comes forward, like, they won't maybe kill his family and all that. And so she carries that burden with her. And even time and culture has its prejudice, and you know, she also loses her girlfriend Alexei. She was a gang shoe, and that really hurt her as well. So she lost a lot of people that really cared about, or that she really cared about, and they cared for her as well. And I believe that drives her to want to fight more and more, and eventually, you know, die for her country and be with her loved ones.
One of the things I was really overcome with in looking at the historical Lilya was that she was continually volunteering for more and more dangerous missions, and I believe that was because she wanted to die a war hero in order to bring honor back to her family, because once she lost her father in the purge, there was, of course, the implication that they were harboring a spy, and maybe other members of her family was a spy. So she really seemed to be in the war simply to die the hero. And I can show you, so far, the comic artwork. This is, as it says there, Moscow, September 1941, when the Nazis had advanced all the way to the outskirts of Moscow. And Lilya is awakened in an air raid. And she lights up a cigarette, puts on her slippers, and grabs a flashlight. And you see there in the middle panel, she actually lives in a rather spacious mansion, but it's rather run down, because during the communist revolution, they got rid of the rich people, and so they had these mansions left over, so they converted it to tenement housing, which is where she lives, and so it's kind of an interesting show of the times. Then we go to page two. You can see, I did hire some relatively good artists to do this. Walton Wong does a lot of inking for Marvel and DC, and he's our art director. I did give them the direction to portray these women as realistic, so I kind of object to the notion that female action heroes have to be treated in such a glamorous style. It didn't really make a ton of sense to me, so. You'll notice she's portrayed relatively realistically there. We see her blonde hair and also the Star of David. And she's looking out on the city during the air raid, and we can see that she's wishing everybody good luck, but that her own inner thoughts are rather dark. By the way, I'm told I'm rather retro in my decision to use thought bubbles as opposed to captions, but I always liked thought bubbles growing up with Spider-Man. So. And she ignores the air raid, and she goes instead to visit a baker who she knows also tends to ignore air raids, and as they talk about it, it's because he can bake lots of pastries while people are hiding, and then when they come out, he gets to sell them. And she jokes with him and says,
because pastry. Series.
She loves coffee, too.
She does, yeah.
Just like me.
I chose to, because a lot of people wanted to have more of a Russian feel, so I decided to make Lilya talk in kind of a very almost broken kind of accent. So instead of, oh, I love coffee, she was like, coffee more important than life. So she goes and buys coffee from her friend Victor, and she's joking about what a capitalist he is for, you know, baking pastries and hoping to sell them, and then she walks out and it turns out that, well, today the Nazis actually are dropping bombs. And then we get this beautifully rendered panel where she's thrown off of her bicycle and rides back and discovers that Victor and the bakery are gone. And there's, in the screenplay, there's, you know, a lot of dramatic scenes and a lot of battle scenes, and Lilya is always at the forefront pushing things to go forward. But I wanted to show in this scene and another couple of scenes that she really would just like a relatively ordinary life, but she doesn't get that opportunity. And later on, she goes up and starts training Ivan in a World War II biplane. Let's see, which this is the Po-2 biplane, which the Soviets made a ton of. And when we're talking about the bomber divisions of the women, they didn't fly big, like, American bombers with four engines. These were their bombers. They would strap four 100-pound bombs and fly them and drop them on Nazi encampments. They were known as the Nachthexen, or Night Witches. And the Po-2 biplane was kind of the backbone of those bomber divisions. So we open up with Lilya teaching Ivan how to fly. And while they're doing that, they're going to end up getting buzzed by one of these. This is a Messerschmitt 110, which ultimately found its biggest use as a night fighter. And since the Night Witches were always bombing at night, the duel between these two planes, as mismatched as it may seem, came up a lot. So I wanted to capture that in my screenplay. So there's a scene that we were going to read.
Oh, yeah.
So.
Are we gonna?
They're up there, you know, and she's teaching him, so she's in the biplane and he has the rear stick, and all of a sudden this Mr. Schmidt comes out of nowhere, and Ivan screams out, "What's he doing?"
Setting up kill shot.
On who? Us? Боже мой.
Don't kill us for him. Bank right.
Shouldn't we run away?
He has 10 times our speed. How far you think we get? Darn!
And so I start turning the plane.
Hey, Fritz! You don't want to see what this Jew could do if this plane had guns.
Why are you trying to provoke him?
Most frustrated men give up after 90 seconds.
And sure enough, Ivan starts turning the plane, which was a common maneuver that the Night Witches would do because they really didn't have any guns and they weren't able to fight those Mr. Schmidt 110s. So they would just turn in a very tight little circle, and the Mr. Schmidts couldn't follow them. And so ultimately, that's how they ended up defending themselves. So I liked that and I wanted to capture it. So I put that in the scene. And then when they eventually go back to land, Ivan is puking his guts out because he's never had his life in that kind of danger before, and that's when the summons comes that Lilya and Katya are going to be inducted into the Soviet Air Force. And I said that, you know, Lilya sees this as a great opportunity and a great challenge. Katya, on the other hand, her motivation becomes that she is trying to protect Lilya because she's in love with her, so that kind of sets up the dramatic tension with Lilya constantly pushing them in more and more danger, and Katya constantly trying to save them. So they go on, and Lilya falls in love with Alexei, much to Katya's chagrin. And that love triangle kind of plays out through the Battle of Stalingrad until ultimately Alexei dies, as we know, which had to happen from history. And then Katya and Lilya get pushed out of the war after the victory at Stalingrad. And now here's where Katya sees her opportunity to try and convince Lilya to kind of allow the war to pass them by, but Lilya, with her goal of being a war hero, won't have it. And so there was a dramatic scene that she wanted to act on. Mm-hmm.
Horses are yielding around Kursk. The enemy has been fortifying their position for 2 years and are soon expected to attack the city. Colonel Shestakov is calling Marinos to defend. I knew you would see this as an opportunity to get back to fight. Give my best to Katya, your brother in arms, Nikolai.
Kursk. Where is this Kursk?
Look how far we pushed them back. 600 kilometers.
The Germans are retreating. They're going to end up in the eastern stronghold.
This might be the largest battle in Russian history.
Here we sit!
It's all right. I'm here with you.
Perhaps we can convince Colonel Shistakov to get to let us back in the fight.
Let's just relax. This war is not a wolf. It's not going to run away into the forest.
Da! I suppose so.
Mm-hmm. We'll be all right. For equality? How long do you think we live? The only other version of us is up there. And I don't want to complicate it with love again. I want us to return up there. We go to Budanova, get transferred.
We kind of see the culmination of Katya's attempt to, you know, kind of heal Lilya and to make her into a complete person and to pull her out of the war. And instead, kind of Lilya's desire to draw them into the war ends up kind of bringing Katya along with her. So they do go before Colonel Shestakov, and through a couple of tricks, they do end up getting assigned to the Battle of Kursk, where historically both of them perished. And Colonel Shestakov gives them a mission, which, again, historically, Lilya accepted a mission which four people had attempted, and one of them did not return, and no one had been successful at eliminating this artillery spotting balloon. And so Lilya came up with a brilliant plan of flying this long, circuitous route way behind enemy lines, which is rather dangerous, but she was able to complete it. And there's another scene where they meet up back with Captain Baranov. We thought we would act out for you. Mm-hmm. So, you two never cease to amaze me. Let us toast. Once there was a flock of birds flying south for the winter. One bird flew higher than all the others and burned his wings on the sun. He defied the collective and he paid the ultimate price. To that bird.
To that bird!
What about Lilya? Any Polish folk tales?
I love story of Prince and Frog.
Prince and Frog?
Da! King wants prince to have wife, so he tell him. Fire arrow from tower and marry whoever closest to landing. So end up with frog.
He married a frog?
I would tell king it landed in a warehouse.
Well, in this story, he married Frog because Frog tell him it's only way to get Arrow back.
The frog talks.
More believable than bird burning wings on his son.
It could have been lightning.
So, Prince takes Frog for wife. And Clever Frog can do magic. So King challenges to make carpet or bake cake. Frog controls helpers.
The frog's a wizard.
Da! Prince wins King's favor and presents his wife, the beautiful Princess Vasilisa.
A wizard's princess.
I tell no more stories.
We should all get some rest. Busy day tomorrow. Never have I met a better warrior or a better friend.
Спасибо, comrade.
Which is Russian, by the way, for thank you. And that actually is an authentic Polish folktale that I thought I would drop in there. But they go and they continue taking more dangerous missions, and Lilya ultimately does perish in combat. And Katya has to realize her failure at trying to protect her. And in reviewing the screenplay and getting notes about it, people just fell in love with Lilya, and I understand it's because she's kind of a classic anti-hero. The system is against her. She has to overcome sexism. But despite all the challenges that are put in her way, she's fighting against the Nazis, who have far better equipment, far better training, and she's flying this piece of shit Yak-1 fighter. But she keeps going, and people just admire that about her. So I know when she died, the audience would kind of be revolting, as though somehow I killed off Batman and left them with Robin. But I feel that Katya really gets to give us Katya allows us to mourn Lilya's passing, and I wrote this passage.
Well, comrade, I realized I never got to tell you a Ukrainian folktale. We were laughing so hard about your story. I thought we would have plenty of time. I grew up with the stories of Baba Yaga, the witch in the woods, and Vasilia. But in my story, Vasilia was a poor girl who was made to suffer at the hands of her cruel stepmother and two stepsisters. They tried to have her killed. They sent her to Baba Yaga's hut to ask for fire, sure that she would get killed. But she didn't die. She didn't die. She returned to her home, and she used that fire to burn it to the ground. She burned them all to ash. Just like you. You will return from certain death, and we will burn our enemies to ash together.
That's a Ukrainian folktale, by the way. Their version of Cinderella is a little more violent.
But justice.
And so that ends up being the story of Kai and Lilya, which I'm attempting to turn into a graphic novel. What I found, again, compelling about them was that when the opportunity came along for them to make a difference, because they had been so marginalized by their society, it made them feel as though they could do so little. But when the opportunity did come, they did take it, and they did attempt to make the best of it. And I feel when I found and I discovered this story, I was going to attempt to make the best of it and attempt to bring it to you. And now I've got a Kickstarter going, and I'm hoping that you will see this as an opportunity for you to come in and to help me tell this story. I'm going to go to questions and answers here, but unless you have something you want to add.
Anybody have any questions for me?
Well, I just have a question for all of you all.
Sure.
In the context of diminishing relations with Russia, have you had any political pushback to portraying Soviet fighter pilots?
If so, no one. I mean, I don't know what's in people's head. So if someone sees something and they're like, I'm not interested in Soviet stuff, then they're just going to walk away, and I have no idea. But no one's gotten in my face about it. I mean, a lot of people just seem to be fascinated with history that they didn't know. These two have been, you know, cosplaying as Katya and Lilya for the whole con, and they get mistaken
for Amelia Earhart.
Amelia Earhart, which is understandable, But it also shows the cultural bias that, you know, we know Amelia, but we don't know, you know, Katya or Lilya or Marina Reskova or any of those people. And, you know, I understand that, yeah, they were Soviets and we didn't like the Soviets, but my point of view is, well, look, the Soviet Empire is gone now. I mean, can't we learn a little bit about their compelling history?
Well, and there's always the adage of, if you don't acknowledge your history, you're doomed to repeat it. And I find particularly that it's much more satisfying to study things from a perspective outside of your own when you're discussing history. Sure, we grow up here with one view of a certain event, but in order to really understand all of the implications of that event, you have to get outside of your own comfort zone and your own knowledge base and discover that, yes, there is a complete other side to it. I mean, we've grown up in America and known that women have been in the skies, but I can't think of a single person this entire weekend that has known, oh yeah, you're Russian fighter pilots, or oh yeah, that was a thing at the time. Many people would even go so far as to say, oh, I didn't think that there were any Russians who were women. That wasn't a thing, was it? So it just goes to show you how one-sided a particular view of history can be unless you take the time to really dig deep and to search outside of that comfort zone. And I think that gives us the challenge to ask more questions and to always seek a second perspective, because you'll be much more well-rounded and much better able to grasp the entirety of the situation and discover that depth to it. That's a great question.
And I guess the other thing I might add to answer that was, my screenplay doesn't portray the Soviet Union as a really wonderful place to live.
Definitely not.
You had mentioned earlier that you would talk to Wyatt's University about turns of the films.
Yes.
And you also mentioned the one with the time searches. Are you finding one half easier or better story? I'm curious what the difference in working.
Well, Landscape is reviewing it. I'm sure I'll hear from them eventually. Statistically, my odds are not overwhelming. Although I was talking with the guy downstairs who's got the history of beer, and ended up being one who was like, oh, you're an LA screenwriter. I'm an LA screenwriter. And one of the things he was saying was that having a screenplay which is kind of standalone isn't connected to, oh, well, I wrote this novel and here's my screenplay annotation of it. He's like, that's the kiss of death. You got to have something else out there. So he's kind of encouraged me to kind of continue pursuing and chugging along and trying to get this produced as a way to enhance the possibility of getting one made.
I think the further point in that is that it's such a dynamic story that just reading the words on the paper doesn't always help with our society of immediacy to get people to see the bigger picture. The idea of having a visual medium for it kind of helps to carry the entire theme through. Whether it be a comic book, graphic novel, or eventually a movie, the idea of putting it in people's faces and allowing them to actually see in front of them the dynamic range of it, I think, is what's going to make it stick more. Having those bombs fly in your face and seeing the faces of the characters as they're struggling with everything that they're going through, I think it brings it much closer to home and it makes it a little bit more relatable than just the words on a page.
I think it would be pretty interesting to also make it to a Broadway play, maybe.
Oh, song and dance, yes please.
Give me a little challenge.
Always
there,
song and dance.
Yes, I think that would be pretty cool. So, something to think about. Really shove it in people's faces and just let them know what's going on and what happened in Russian history and everything. Your question.
Son.
Where does the title come from?
Oh, I'm sorry. You know, I should have mentioned that. Lilya Litvyak, that was her aviator call sign. You know, like Maverick is what, you know, Pete Mitchell's aviator call sign is, and Top Gun, hers was White Lily. In the screenplay, it kind of takes on a more symbolic meaning, and that Kai is constantly giving Lilya the White Lily, which is what she then chooses to be her aviator call sign. And then after Lily is gone, Katya, takes the White Lily and puts it in her cockpit, and so it kind of adopts this symbolic meaning.
It kind of, the White Lily ends up somewhat representing that little bit of cherished hope that still resides in the characters. They're faced with overwhelming odds. They know that they're going into battle and most likely will not be coming back, but they still take this Lily and attach it to the dash, and that kind of helps be that visual reminder that, you know, there's still something here that we're fighting for, and there's still a hope that that is going to endure even through what all happens. And at the end of the screenplay, my character actually, her plane lands in a field of them. So it represents that even though she has personally been defeated, perhaps the ideals that she is representing might carry through and endure.
And my lilies are beautiful, so after the war is over, hopefully it'll be a more beautiful world.
Beautiful and resilient.
Exactly.
When you were doing your research, didn't you find that the Soviets, by and large, use women in like all aspects of warfare more than the other allies did?
Yes.
Absolutely.
Yes, they did. Although I feel that was not necessarily ideological, although they certainly claim it was. They claim that ideologically they were like, well, of course we use women, Marx said we should all be equal. But at the same time, homosexuality was a crime. They were clearly very racist, you know, depending on if you were Ukrainian. It was simply necessity. You know, the Nazis were coming and they killed 20 million Russians. And so, you know, you're putting your best, finest Russian men and Russian fighter pilots out there, and well, they all got killed. So, well, what else have we got?
Keep it coming. What else do you have? We'll take you. We'll take
right.
your women. You got kids? We'll take your kids. Let's throw them in there too. Why
and,
not?
And part of the reason why we saw their contributions the most in aviation, although they were, you know, women snipers as well as women tank gunners. But I think the reason we see the highest profile in aviation is that it takes a certain set of skills and training to fly a plane. And the Soviet air divisions were experiencing 90-95% casualty rates, like entire squadrons just being obliterated, and they were running out of people who had the skills, so it's turned to women.
And it's unique that at that particular moment of time, the women were kind of given that in. They were given that, here's your chance, get up there and do something. But nobody necessarily thought that something would amount to it. It was more, here's an extra body to do the thing.
Right.
But the women actually ended up coming through and had such great skill sets inherently that they were able to succeed in a way that nobody else was. Perhaps it was because they weren't given the same amount of training and background that the men were, so they didn't know, think X, Y, and Z. They were kind of freewheeling in it. They had a different perspective, so maybe they were able to come at it from a completely different point of view and were able to accomplish that new feat. But because of it, we had the very first women who were given commendations for service in the military. Lilya was the first woman to be given, was it the Soviet commendation for service to the Union?
Hero of the Soviet Union? Or?
That's the one, the hero of the Soviet Union.
Well,
very first woman to be given that.
Well, Marina Raskova got that one, actually.
She was the first,
Lilya
was received a different award at the similar time. But this was the first time that women were actually noticed for having achieved these feats and were highlighted for it, which was actually very surprising for the time.
Yeah, I mean, I think the Soviet commanders were looking at them as less good soldiers, like, well, we've run out of prime soldiers, let's go to the ones who were just kind of next, just because we got to put bodies out there. But when it came to, like, the night bomber division, there were also men who were flying those same missions in those same planes. And what they found is the women actually outperformed the men because they were flying multiple sorties every night. And you should do like four or five missions, and they found the women consistently performed more missions than the men did. And that's because when the men would come back from a mission, they would stop and smoke. And the women would just like, let's go.
And they had something to prove, and they had to prove it rather than just, this is a thing that we have to do. And it seemed to make all of the difference.
Yes. And I actually do show that in the screenplay, and that after the victory of at Stalingrad, you know, their two most decorated and highest number of killed pilots are now relegated back to training because the commander who was in charge is like, you know, he kind of viewed women as, or having to use women as kind of a blight upon his air divisions.
Yeah,
So they were moved back into the training center rather than allowed to continue that service, which is actually a point of huge contention between the two main characters in the screenplay. Lily is furious that she's done all of this work to reach this peak and finally be shown for the skill set that she has, and then she's forced to just go back and shuffle back into the background, and that just infuriates her and causes this huge set of dissension between her and the other main character. So he definitely takes the time to highlight that tension, and then it's only when they're very short of forces again that the women are allowed to go forward, and then they end up being killed in battle.
Thanks for coming in. If you want to back the Kickstarter, which I'm asking everybody to do, you can just go to whitelilymovie.com and that'll forward you right to the Kickstarter URL. And other than that, thank you for your time.